brother. So 1 Peter chapter 1, Ephesians 4, and 2 Corinthians chapter 2. And as always, what we will want to do as we start this morning is read through the areas of Scripture that we're going to look at, and we're going to read through optimistically. Don't know that we'll get through all that we read through, but at least give us a framework. So beginning in chapter 1 of 1 Peter, at verse 22, Peter writes and he says, "Since you have purified your souls in obeying the truth through the Spirit in sincere love of the brethren, love one another fervently with a pure heart, having been born again, not of corruptible seed, but incorruptible, through the word of God which lives and abides forever. Because all flesh is as grass, and all the glory of man is the flower of the grass. The grass withers and its flower falls away, but the word of the Lord endures forever. Now this is the word which by the gospel was preached to you. Therefore, laying aside all malice, all deceit, hypocrisy, envy, and all evil speaking, as newborn babes, desire the pure milk of the word, that you may grow thereby, if indeed you have tasted that the Lord is gracious. Coming to him as to a living stone, rejected indeed by men, but chosen by God and precious. You also, as living stones, are being built up a spiritual house, a holy priesthood, to offer up spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God through Jesus Christ. Therefore, it is also contained in the Scripture, 'Behold, I lay in Zion a chief cornerstone, elect, precious, and he who believes on him will by no means be put to shame.' Therefore, to you who believe, he is precious. But to those who are disobedient, the stone which the builders rejected has become the chief cornerstone, and a stone of stumbling and a rock of offense. They stumble, being disobedient to the word to which they also were appointed. But you are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, his own special people, that you may proclaim the praises of him who called you out of darkness into his marvelous light, who once were not a people, but are now the people of God, who had not obtained mercy, but now have obtained mercy." We pause in our reading there, and I draw your attention back to verse 22 of chapter 1 as we take a look at kind of a running introduction, as we did last Sunday, to where we are here in the book of Peter. Just a couple of notes. First of all, of course, Peter is writing to Christians who are suffering persecution. They're relatively new believers, and he's encouraging them in their faith and trust in God. He's encouraging them in the hope that is for their future, that is the hope of the return of the Lord and them seeing the Lord face to face. And he's going to be encouraging them in their behavior, their actions, and their activities as followers of the Lord Jesus Christ. And as we've made note, in the face of persecution, sometimes the first thing that can go, if we're not careful, is our walk and our witness for the Lord. So Peter is desiring to lay down here in these first two chapters almost, the first chapter and a half, kind of everything that these Christians have, everything that the Lord has done for them, and then he's going to go into talking about how this should affect their behavior. Now, last week, we started in verse 13, and let me just kind of give you a flyby of what we looked at beginning in verse 13. Peter's making the case that because we as believers are waiting for the rapture as one waits for dessert, verse 14, and we're not conforming ourselves to the way of this world, then verse 15, we should then be holy in all of our conduct, holy, just as God is holy. And in verse 17, since we pray to God our Father, who seeks to reward us for the good that we do, we should live in reverence toward God, verse 18, because we know we were not bought out of this aimless world with money, verse 19, but with the costly blood of the perfect Lamb of the Messiah, verse 20, who was made known in these days for us who believe in God, and believe that he was resurrected from the dead, and we therefore believe that we too will be resurrected. So there's an encapsulation of what we looked at last week. So picking up in verse 22 then of chapter 1, Peter says, since you have purified your souls, and we understand that because he's been talking about this holiness, since you have purified your souls in obeying the truth through the Spirit in sincere love of the brethren, love one another fervently with a pure heart. We pause right there. Peter, he says, Christian, since you have purified your soul, since you've been washed in the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ, since you've been made whole and holy through the sacrifice of the Lamb, since you purified your souls in obeying the truth, notice the phrase there, the truth of the Word, the truth of Christ, the truth of God, the truth of the Scripture, through the Spirit, in sincere love of the brethren. And this is very interesting. Peter is making an assessment of these Christians' love, of their relationships with each other. He says, since you've purified your souls in obeying the truth of the Spirit in sincere love of the brethren, this is the love of phileo. This is Philadelphia, city of brotherly love. This is phileo love. Hey, Christians, because you have been cleansed by the Holy Spirit, purified by the Holy Spirit, you know what? You really like each other. That's what he's saying. You really like each other. And here's the way phileo love works. I like you, you like me. I like you because you fish, and I fish. I really like you because, you know what? You quilt and I quilt. I really like you because you're a scrapper, just like I'm a scrapper. We have something in common. We like each other. We have a love for the brethren because, you know what? We're a lot alike. There's something similar about us. Peter looks on at these believers who are in persecution, who are going to come into even more intense persecution, and he makes an assessment about their relationship with each other. He goes, you know what? You guys really like each other. You really like each other if you share some same similarities. What's the opposite of that? Well, you know what? If you don't fish, if you don't quilt, if you don't scrap, I don't really like you. I don't have anything in common with you. Yeah, you know what? I've tried to be your friend, and you've tried to be my friend, but it just hasn't worked because we don't have anything in common. There's nothing similar between us. See, and what happens is when persecution, trial, difficulty, and challenge comes, those kind of relationships fall apart. Because all of a sudden, when there's persecution, you know what? You don't care about scrapping, and I don't either. You don't care about fishing, and I don't either. Don't raise your hand or shout out, but if in the last week or two you personally have entered into a storm, somebody in your family has died, somebody in your family has got very sick, something has developed that's been a huge life-altering event in your life. You know that right now, that's the only thing that you can think about. And the fact of the matter is, there's probably nobody else in this room who's having that same experience. And so guess what? You are not having a similar experience with somebody. You may be feeling alone. Do you see that? The challenge, the tribulation of life comes, and you go, wait a minute. I'm the only one in this whole church that experienced a death in my family this last week. All of a sudden, the people that I fish with, the people that I scrap with, the people that I quilt with, the people that I cook with, we don't have that same similarity. You know what? I'm not feeling the love. Peter, he prepares these Christians by saying, look, you've been purified in your souls by obeying the truth of God through the Spirit. In sincere love of the brethren, here comes the exhortation. Look at the next phrase. He says, love one another fervently with a pure heart. Christian, don't love those who are similar to you, and don't love them because they're similar. Christian, you are to love every other Christian. Love one another fervently. And guess what? The word love here, no longer phileo. You can probably guess what it is. Agape. It's agape love. It's a love that comes from the heart. It's a love that's willing to sacrifice one for another. It's the love that put Jesus on the cross. I'll die for you, although you're not love worthy, so to speak. I love you so much, I will sacrifice for you. Peter says to them, hey, stop loving those who are just like you. See, there are some of us who will never get involved in church because no one's friendly. And the Bible says you have to be friendly to have a friend. There are some of us who will never get involved in the body of Christ because you know what? There's no one here like me. What Peter wants us to see is that everybody that is here is like you. We've all been bought by the blood of Jesus Christ. We're all waiting for that same dessert of the rapturous return of the Lord. We're all going to heaven together. Love one another fervently. The love one another, the love, we got that. That's the agape. The one another, it's a mutual love or it's a reciprocal love. This is a cautionary tale. Because again, in our flesh, we'll say this. You know what? I'm okay to phileo you. You know, I'm okay to like have a similar kind of love with you. And when I see you start to agape me, then I'll agape you. I mean, you want to talk about divorce in a marriage? You want to talk about train wreck in a marriage? You allow that one to come in. When you start loving me, I'll start loving you. Oh, my goodness gracious. Well, the same thing happens in the body of Christ. We are to love one another fervently. We are to agape. We are to mutually love one another. We are to have a reciprocal relationship of agape love, of self-sacrificial love for each other. Look at this next word. It's not enough for it to be an agape love that's from the heart, that is sacrificial, that is for one another, reciprocal. But it's also supposed to be fervent. Fervent. It's to be a strong love. It's to be a fervent love, a love that strains you. Watch this. Watch this. This word fervently, it literally means this. From the Greek into the English, it means this. As on the rack. Now, that's not bike rack. That is the rack, like, you know, I should have thought through this illustration before I got to it. But you know the rack where like, what's the word that I want when you, not persecution, torture. It's the rack of torture where you tie somebody into this thing and you start cranking them up and stretching them out and stretching them around. You're on the rack and it's hurt and it's pain and it's disjointing to your members. This is what Peter is saying. I mean, this is over the top exhortation. Love one another fervently so that you are, watch this, not on the rack, so that you're stretched. See, to love you phileo, it's really not a stretcher at all. To love you phileo, I kind of look through the body of Christ and the same people that are into the same things that I'm in. Hey, we got something similar. We got something in common. Okay, we'll be friends. This will be great. The stretcher comes for me to love sacrificially, intensely, fervently, where I am stretched to have a relationship with you because we have nothing in common but Jesus. Now we know this to be true and we know that this can work because here's the thing. If we come together and we only ever talk about the hobby you have and the hobby that I have in common, if that's the only communication that we ever have, you know what? Things are kind of cool. But if we don't have that in common, well now what do we talk about? And this is where fellowship is so sweet. Fellowship is talking about Jesus. Fellowship is talking about His Word. Fellowship is talking about what the Holy Spirit is doing in our lives. You and I automatically have that in common. It draws us closer to each other. It draws us closer to the Lord. And you know what? It just might stretch us. Because God's doing different things in your life than He's doing in my life. And we're not getting to talk about our hobbies, the things that we know so well, but we're being stretched to care for one another and to pray for each other and to minister to each other. Since you've purified your souls in obeying the truth through the Spirit and sincere love of the brethren, love one another fervently with a pure heart. Someone once wrote, "You may recognize it and know it well. Love suffers long and is kind. Love does not envy. Love does not parade itself. It's not puffed up. Love doesn't behave rudely. Love doesn't seek its own. It's not provoked. It thinks no evil. Love does not rejoice in iniquity, but it rejoices in the truth. Love, it bears all things. It believes all things. It believes the best about all things. It hopes all things. It endures all things. Love never fails." 1 Corinthians 13. This is that love that Peter speaks of. How much more so during times of persecution does this love need to be ramped up and amped up in our lives? John writes in 1 John 3, "We know that we've passed from death to life because we love the brethren. He who does not love his brother abides in death." Peter says there shouldn't just be this phileo love that we have for each other because, you know what, you're here, I'm here, we're kind of doing the same thing. But we should have a fervent love for each other, a love that stretches us, and it should be a love that comes from a pure heart. We'll get more on that in a little bit. Verse 23, we're going to have love for one another fervently with a pure heart, having been born again. This is like the fourth time Peter's talked about being born again. It's intrinsic to Peter's argument. If you haven't been born again, you're going, what's he talking about? I can't even relate. Well, no, you can't relate, because the spiritual things can only be understood by the Spirit. You have to be born again. But his assumption is, of those that are reading this at these churches that are receiving this letter, that you've been born again, not of corruptible seed, but incorruptible, through the word of God, which lives and abides forever. Now, verse 24 and following are a commentary on verse 23. So we camp for just a moment on verse 23. And this is why I said this morning, there's a couple key elements here that we so need. And that's why I don't know how we're going to get through this morning, what's going to happen. Because I want to make sure that we hold on to these and we have these, that we own these concepts. This first one of just not loving each other phileo, but loving each other agape, loving each other fervently, loving each other to the point of being stretched. But doing so on the foundation, doing so within the idea of having been born again, and look at this, through this concept, this truth, this reality about, well, the Word of God, which lives and abides forever. A couple things I want you to see here about this. This Word of God, it lives and abides forever. The word lives there, the tense and the definition tell us the word lives, it means it actively possesses life. Now, this is going to be important because in a moment I'm going to share an illustration with you. And if you don't get the definition, when I share the illustration, you're going to be like, so what? But check this out. Through the Word of God, which lives, the Word of God, God's Word, the Bible, the Scriptures, the Word, it lives and abides forever. It actively possesses life. It lives and abides forever. It lives and it abides. It means it is permanent and it is non-changing. The word lives, it actively possesses life, and it abides. It's permanent and non-changing. Just a little side note. Anytime you hear somebody representing Christianity say, well, that's what the Bible used to mean back then. We don't believe that anymore. I mean, the Bible changes with the times. There are numerous. This is just one of them. There are numerous verses that refute that. That God's Word, the Bible, it actively possesses life, and it is permanent and non-changing. And look at that last word. Forever. So it was some time ago, an individual here from the fellowship told me a story, and I asked their permission if I could share it, and they said yes. But they were going through their day, and they were experiencing struggles. one struggle after another. Just the enemy hammering on them, causing questioning in their mind and their heart, just struggling with particular issues in their life. And as they made their way through their day, they constantly came back to, you know what? I don't think I'm going to go to church tonight. I just, you know what? It's been too hard of a day, too many challenges. These things are just really beating me up in my head and my heart. I'm just going to skip it. But as the evening rolled around, they made the determination, you know what, I'll just go. I'm usually there, I'll just go. So they came to church. And they pulled in the parking lot, and when they pulled in the parking lot, they got a phone call from somebody that they were supposed to meet here. And that person said to them, you know what, not going to make it tonight, I can't meet you. And they said to themselves, you know what, I really didn't want to come here in the first place. And now, the person that I'm supposed to meet, they're not going to be here. I'm just going to drive back on out of the parking lot. Now, I don't know about you, but that when I heard that, that tugged at my heartstrings. It was like, oh, you were in the parking lot. You were that close to the door. And you were going to like just pull back out. That's so sad, you know. But they overcame. You know what? Okay, I'm here. I may as well come in. They came in. They sat down. And as they would tell me, as we went through worship, they felt the stress, the strain, the pull, the conflict of the day, this is their word, washed away from them. It melted away as they went through worship. That by the time we came into the Bible study, they were kind of like going, well, okay, I think, you know, I might, you know, I'm kind of ready to maybe hear something, you know. It's like, okay, you know, I can go on for a couple more hours. You know, let's see what this is all about. And then they said, and this is the reason we had that conversation, it was the most amazing thing. The things that you talked about in the Bible study tonight are the exact things I've been struggling with all day. It's like I showed up at church and God answered my questions. It's like I came to church and God knew exactly what I've been struggling with all day. And as I walked in the doors and I sat down, He washed out of me the things of the day that I was, you know, that were just like holding me back and not to be able to hear Him. And then He began to proceed to minister to me and meet me in the place of where my questions and my challenges and my tribulations were. It's the Word of God which lives, it actively possesses life and abides, it's permanent and non-changing absolutely forever. Now there are many areas of scripture that speak about this, but I want to read to you three of them. And I've determined, I just want to read them to you. I just want you to listen and allow them to wash over you. Isaiah 55, 10 and 11. For as the rain comes down and the snow from heaven, and do not return there, but water the earth, and make it bring forth, the earth bring forth and bud, that it may give seed to the sower and bread to the eater. So shall be my word that goes forth from my mouth, God says. It shall not return to me void, but it shall accomplish what I please, and it shall prosper in the thing for which I sent it. Isaiah 55. God says, my word, anytime it goes forth, whether you pick it up to just read through it, or someone is reading it to you, I've been in situations before where I've handed people my Bible, and I've said, would you just please read to me? Just read. I just want to hear it. Just Deuteronomy 6, verse 4 through 9. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your strength. And these words which I command you today shall be in your heart. These words that I command you today, they shall be in your heart. You shall teach them diligently to your children. You shall talk of them when you sit in your house, when you walk by the way, when you lie down, and when you rise up. You shall bind them as a sign on your hand, and they shall be as frontlets between your eyes. You shall write them on the doorposts of your house and on your gates. It's the Word. It's all about the Word. There's not a thing that's going on in our lives that God can't minister to us through the Word. A thing that needs to be corrected, a thing that needs to be controlled, an area that needs to be healed, an issue that needs to be dealt with. God's Word can minister to us in everything. God's Word has everything that we need for life and for living. And then Psalm 119, Psalm 119, longest psalm in the Bible, and the whole thing is about the Word. But the one verse that I picked out, a lot to choose from, but it says this one: how can a young man cleanse his way? By taking heed according to your Word. See, Christians at Calvary Chapel, Peter, writing to these Christians in these five cities, we're all seeing and going to see persecution. And to be reminded on this side of it, that it is God's Word which lives and abides forever. It's too great a truth to take lightly. I don't know whether you really related to the little story that I told or not, but that little story, that should impact us. That's one person's story, but that's each of our stories as well. This is where, sitting under the teaching of God's Word, whether here, I don't mean here, this location, but sitting under the teaching of God's Word, whether it's in our prayer closet, whether it's in a church service or a Bible study, this is where God does His work. I'm telling you, He doesn't do His work with us all going to bed early because we're tired. He doesn't do His work with us all staying in bed because we're tired. He doesn't do His greatest work because we all need to know what the latest news shows are saying on Sunday morning. And I'm preaching to the choir because you're all here, but you know of what I speak. I think it's just great to be reminded of the fact that it's God's Word that is life-changing. In fact, Peter, God bless him, look at this. He quotes Isaiah 40, verses 6 through 8. I'm back in our text. He says this: all flesh, that's you and me, all flesh is as grass, and all the glory of man as the flower of the grass. The grass withers, and if you want to circle that word withers, the tense of it is continuously withers. The grass continuously withers, and its flowers fall away. King James, falleth. Its flowers continually fall away. So the glory of man, it's like grass. It continuously withers. It continuously falls away. The contrast, verse 25, but the word of the Lord endures forever. The word of the Lord endures forever. Now, this is even better. Lest you think that what I just talked about regarding the word was like super cool. And I know you do. The word here for word is not this word. The word here for word is rhema, R-H-E-M-A, rhema, and it speaks to the spoken word of God, the spoken word of God. The grass withers, its flowers fall away, but the word, the spoken word of God, which is recorded here in the Bible, you want to know what God has to say? Read your Bible. What would God say in this situation? Read your Bible. One of the things, and you know what, I'm just going to stop and do a public service announcement right now here in the middle of this verse. Don't often do this. But, and I know a number of you have discovered this because I've had to keep making copies, but there may be a couple here in the room that aren't. On the back, there's sets of information on both tables in the back, but the one that's on my left, currently on your right, there is a yellow sheet of paper. It's tri-folded, and it's entitled Finding Help in the Bible. There may be one person in the room right now that's going, you know what, I really believe what you're saying about, you know, it being God's Word and it being the rhema, God's spoken word, return, you know, in the Scriptures, but I don't know where to find anything. Well, there are a multitude of ways to find things in the Bible, but this particular sheet entitled Finding Help in the Bible on a yellow sheet, trifold, on the information table on my left, your right, see I'm repeating, as you sit in the back, can go through. And it, you know what, if you're feeling depressed, if you're feeling scared, if you're feeling joyful, if you're feeling concerned, if you need comfort, it gives you, you can look up all these scriptures that will God, through His rhema, through His spoken voice, will speak to you through His Word on that particular topic. I think there's 10 back there. If they're all gone, we'll make more. Help yourself. See, the grass withers and its flower falls away, but the word of the Lord endures forever. Now, this is the word, this spoken word of the Lord. I'm in verse 25. The spoken word of the Lord that endures forever. This is the word which by the gospel was preached to you. The gospel was proclaimed to you. The gospel was announced to you. Here's the wrap-up. In this summation, as I quote from Warren Wiersbe, those who delight in God's word meditate on it and seek to obey it, and they will experience God's direction and blessing in their lives. That's Psalm 1, verses 1 through 3. Blessed is he. He shall be like a tree planted by the streams of water. The word, God's word, reveals to us God's mind, Wiersbe says, so we should learn it. It reveals to us God's heart, so we should love it. It reveals to us God's will, so we should live it. I love those couplets. The word, God's word, reveals to us his mind, so we should learn it. It reveals to us his heart, so we should love it. It reveals to us his will, so we should live it. Our whole being, mind, will, and heart should be controlled by the Word of God. That's just like Deuteronomy 6. And everything about us should be guided and directed by the will. Well, with that, then, in Peter is then able to say, look at it there with me, 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 1, he's able to say, therefore, because you should be loving one another fervently, being stretched as on a rack with a pure heart, because you've been born again incorruptible, through the word of God, which lives and abides forever, because this is the word in the gospel that was spoken to you, therefore, Christian, you've been given new life. You've been given a new love, no longer just phileo, agape. You've been given the unchanging and the enduring word because you've been given these things, Christian. Therefore, you're going to have a new activity. Who you are and how you act and how you relate to others and how you speak, these things are going to be changed and transformed. Peter says, because all of this over here has happened into your lives, it happened in your lives through the Word, through the work of the Holy Spirit, through the purifying work of God's Word, because all of this has happened, therefore this over here is going to be changed and transformed. Therefore, here's what you're going to do. Look at it. Two things to see. Number one, therefore, laying aside all malice, all deceit, hypocrisy, envy, and all evil speaking as newborn babes, desire, number two, number one is lay aside, number two is desire. Desire the pure milk of the word that you may grow thereby, if indeed you have tasted that the Lord is gracious. Therefore, based on everything that we've looked at, Peter says, lay aside. Now, you may want to make a note in the margin of your Bible or as you're taking notes. The idea of laying aside is the idea of putting off like a coat. And it's an imperative. You could put a little exclamation point there after the word aside. Laying aside! Lay it aside! Take your coat off now! Set it down. You don't need it. It's not raining anymore. Take off your coat. You're inside. Some people are like, would you please stop that? I'm still waking up. Therefore, laying aside. Not only is it an imperative, do it now. It is also of a tense that says do it once and for all. Therefore, because these changes have happened in your life, because God has done this, lay aside now, once and for all. Let there be a separation from these things in your life. Lay them aside. Now, I asked you to find Ephesians 4 because we're going to kind of give it away. Ephesians 4, look at Ephesians 4, verse 20. This is where Paul writes about the same concept. I opened this service by reading to you from Colossians 3, where Paul speaks about the same thing. Ephesians 4, verse 20. Paul says, "You have not so learned Christ, if indeed you have heard him and have been taught by him, as the truth is in Jesus," verse 22, "that you put off concerning your former conduct the old man which grows corrupt according to deceitful lusts, and be renewed in the spirit of your mind, that you put on the new man which was created according to God in true righteousness and holiness." Paul says, put off the old guy and put on the new guy. Put off the old gal's way of doing things and put on the new gal's ways of doing things in true righteousness and holiness. Well, what does that look like? Well, Paul, he defines that as you go along in Ephesians or if you go along in Colossians. But of course, we're over in Peter. I just wanted us to see that connection, that this is a concept that runs through Scripture. Look at back at Peter, 1 Peter 2. Therefore, laying aside... Oh, wait a minute. There's another word there. Did you see it? Laying aside. And then it doesn't go into the list. Look, it says laying aside all. The word all here, it's kind of a specific and a unique word. It means in every aspect and in every way we're to do this thing, even in how we think. The word all is encompassing every aspect of who we are as an individual. From that which can be seen, heard, or even what we think. See, it's one thing for me to not treat you rudely. It's a whole nother thing for me to not think about you rudely. It's one thing for me to not treat you maliciously. It's a whole nother thing for me to not think of you in a malicious manner. The Holy Spirit speaking through Peter leaves nothing to chance. He says, therefore, laying aside all malice, all deceit, and the inference is all hypocrisy, all envy, and all evil speaking. Not only in your actions, not only in what you say, but how you think. See, some of us really struggle because we got the deal down with the outside. No one would ever look on at us and call us a hypocrite. No one would ever look on at us and say, oh, she is an evil speaker. Or he is just one malicious man. No one would say that. But maybe for some of us, right here in the mind, we never speak it or do it, but we think it. Now, one of the things that some of you communicated to me last week, which I really appreciated that feedback, was when I read down through that list of sins, it was kind of like, whoa, you know, technicolor. Because sometimes the poor communicator that I am, I just use kind of some of the same examples of sin, you know, and just kind of hope that everybody fills in the blank, you know, with their own sin. But last week I didn't do that. I read through a list of probably 60 or 70 sins in different categories, you know. There were some people that were impacted by that. I was as well. So I'm going to bless you again this morning. Same author, I forgot to mention him last week, but this is William MacDonald. This is worth reading. What he's going to do for us, instead of me defining each and every one of these words for you, He's going to do it for us, and I like the way he does that. So here we go, little extended reading, but it's okay, you'll make it through. All right, so therefore laying aside all, first word, malice. It's the harboring of evil thoughts, the harboring, I'm holding on to them. Don't lose me. The harboring, I'm holding on to evil thoughts against another person. Malice nourishes or feeds antagonism, builds up grudges, and secretly hopes that revenge, harm, or tragedy will overtake another. It's malice. I hope you get what's coming to you. It's malice. Now, deceit. Deceit is any form of dishonesty and trickery. Any form. One of the things that I found coming into the Christian community is I came into the Christian community with a real issue in my background. I had some, still do have some serious flaws, you know, but some of the big ones that the Lord dealt with me originally were, well, I came into the body of Christ as a liar. It's something that I'm sensitive to now because the Lord has done such a work in my life as I strive to try and attain the truth, try and communicate the truth. But what I've noticed in the body of Christ is there are many within Christianity that they won't straight up lie. They just kind of tell half the truth. Or they'll put a little twist on it. And Peter says that's deceit, any form of dishonesty and trickery. Deceit, it falsifies income tax returns, cheats on exams, lies about one's age, unless you're a woman. No, he didn't write that. Lies about age. I'm just reading what he wrote, okay? I'm just reading it. It's not like I wrote it. I'm just reading it. Okay, he lies about it. Why'd I have to read it again? Bribes officials, the deceitful person bribes officials and pulls shady deals in business. Deceit, it's any form of dishonesty and trickery. Hypocrisy, that's our next word. Lay aside all hypocrisy. Hypocrisy is insincerity, pretense, or sham. The hypocrite is a play actor pretending to be someone he is not. He pretends to be happily married when his home is actually a battlefield. He pretends to be spiritual on Sundays, but he is as carnal as a goat on weekdays. See, I could never come up with that, carnal as a goat. I'm not that kind of a poet. He pretends interest in others. He pretends interest, the hypocrite pretends interest in others. But his motives are selfish. Therefore, laying aside all malice, all deceit, all hypocrisy, and envy. Envy is bare-faced jealousy. Envy is a killer. Women can look daggers at others because of their better homes and gardens, smarter clothes, or superior cooking. A man can praise another fellow's new car or speedboat, but what he's thinking is, I'll show him I'll get something better. It's envy, jealousy. Laying aside all malice, all deceit, hypocrisy, envy, and finally, all evil speaking. Evil speaking, MacDonald writes, it's backbiting. It's malicious gossip. It's recrimination. I like this. I got this from someplace else. Evil speaking, it's speaking down about someone. I like that. It's speaking down. You're down there. And the more I speak about you down there, the more up here I am. It's being degrading to or about others. He says evil speaking, it's the attempt to make oneself look cleaner by slinging mud at someone else. In fact, he says it may take very subtle forms such as, yes, she is a lovely person, but she has this one failing. Or, and then as he says, then the knife is deftly thrust into her back. Or it might even have a religious pose. I mention this only for your prayer fellowship, but did you know that he... And then the character is assassinated. McDonald says, all these sins are violations of the fundamental commandment to love our neighbor as ourselves. No wonder Peter tells us to decisively rid ourselves of these things. Therefore, because of all that Jesus has done for us, the new life that he's given us, because we have an agape, self-sacrificial love for each other, because we are being fed upon God's unchanging word, therefore lay aside all malice, all deceit, hypocrisy, envy, and all evil speaking. And what are we going to replace it with? Stop a minute. And just right now, I just want you all to know, we are not going to finish everything that we read for the text today. So we'll just, everybody relax. It's going to be good. The roast in the oven will be just fine. See, we have to note here a second. Verse one is lay aside. Verse two introduces what we're going to, you're going to lay this aside. What are you going to replace it with? And here's something I want us to make sure that we know as Christians. When we seek the Lord to take something out of our life, Lord, take that away from me. I don't want to be malicious. I don't want to be envious. I don't want to be jealous. Lord, remove that from my life. There is in the understanding, there's an understanding in our asking the Lord to take this thing out that we're going to allow something else in. I don't know if you've ever struggled with any besetting sins. But maybe you are like, oh, you know what? I need to stop smoking. I need to stop smoking. It's killing me. I need to stop smoking. And so what you determine is, you know what I'm going to do? I'm going to stop smoking, but I'm going to drink Diet Coke. And pretty soon, instead of going from 2 packs a day of cigarettes, you go to 2 liters a day of Diet Coke. You're taking something out. You need to put something else in. And what you want to make sure that that which you're putting in is something that lifts you up and builds you up. And this is the example Peter gives. Look at this. You're going to lay aside these things, but as newborn babes, here's what I want you to do. I want you to desire the pure milk of the word. The word desire here, linked with the concept of a newborn babe, is desire. It is one that is hungry, it is one that is impatient, it is one that is intense, it is one that is yearning for the pure milk of the word. You remember what it was like when you had a brand new baby? Some of you are like going, yes, I remember it at about 3 a.m. this morning. Babies, they need to eat with seeming regularity, about every 90 minutes or so, sometimes it seems. And I remember when we first got our baby, you know, took it out of the package, put the batteries in, you know, wow, this is so cool, baby, you know, all right, this is great. And for me, you know, I wasn't nursing. My wife was. No, there's a reason for it. There's a reason I'm just pointing that out. Because when baby got hungry and baby was kind of like start to fuss and my wife would say, hey, I need to go feed the baby. I'd be like, you know what, let's just finish what we're doing here a minute, okay? The baby can wait. It'll be all right. You know, we're not going anywhere. Now, it's only the ladies that are laughing. Because you know what the issue is, right? That is just like a tiny little storm that is going to turn into a hurricane. That's just like a little cold front that's going to become something that's going to destroy your home. That child needs to eat, and eat now. That's this word desire. As newborn babes, desire. I have to have it now. Now. Not 5 minutes from now. Not 5 seconds from now. I want to eat now. The Greek scholar Wiest, he says this. The prerequisite to the act of intensely yearning for the Word of God is the act of once for all putting sin out of our lives. Sin in the life destroys the appetite for the Word. If you're feeding on sin, you will not desire the pure milk of the Word. It's just a law. Fight it. Argue it. Stomp your feet. Do whatever you want. You will not change it. If you're living in sin, you will not desire the milk of the Word. He goes on, he says, the Christian who tries to find satisfaction in the husks of the world has no appetite left for the things of God. If when you're feeling worried, you're feeling nervous, you're feeling concerned and uptight about life, you continuously turn to Jimmy Fallon, that's what you're going to get. If late night television is the solution to the problems of your lives, you're not going to desire the pure milk of the Word. Me, when life became too much for me, I used to drink. Man, I learned it much later, self-medicating. You know, it's Thanksgiving. 90 relatives are coming together. 1 o'clock is the big meal. I'd start drinking at 10 a.m. You know, so I was good on down the road, ready. So like at 1 a.m. hit, I was there where I thought I needed to be. And I'm not going to desire the pure milk of the Word. Far from it. Weiss continues, his heart is filled with the former and has no room left for the latter. His heart is filled with the things of the world. There's no room for the things of God. He says this, a healthy infant is a hungry infant. A spiritually healthy Christian is a hungry Christian. And then in this conclusion I just love, he says, this solves the problem of why so many children of God have so little love for the Word. They love the world. There's no love for the Word because they love the world. They're feeding off the things of the world. There isn't a space or a place for them to be hungry for the things of the Word. Peter says, lay these things of the world, of sin, of the flesh aside, and as newborn babes, here's what you need to do. Desire the pure milk of the Word. The Word that's not entertaining, watch this, but engaging. See, we didn't come here this morning to be entertained, did we? I hope not. Oh my goodness. Because you really got sold short. We didn't come here to be entertained this morning. We came to be engaged. I want to think. I want to be changed. I want to be challenged. I want to walk out different than I walked in. I want to walk out more comforted than when I walked in. I want to walk in more exhorted. I want to walk out more joy-filled than when I walked in. I want to be engaged with what God is doing. Look at this. As newborn babes desire the pure milk of the Word, well, why would they do that? That you may grow or make progress unto maturity thereby. As newborn babes, that we desire the pure milk of the Word, that we would grow thereby. And then the word if at the beginning of verse 3, you can put a little line through that and you can write the word since. This is another one of those if that really means since. If you're going to the store, would you get milk for me? Since you're going to the store, will you get milk for me? As newborn babes desire the pure milk of the Word that you may grow thereby, since indeed you have tasted that the Lord is gracious. There's not a question mark at the end of the sentence. In the syntax, especially here in the English, we can kind of maybe want to have it put there, but it's not. The sentence ends with a period. Since indeed, yes, you have. You have tasted. And the word taste is not taste like, it's a little salty. No, it's appropriated. It's tasted. Like last night, I tasted a hamburger cooked on the grill. There's nothing left. I mean, I tasted it. Wolf, 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 wolf. I've tasted it. Indeed, you have tasted that the Lord is gracious, that He is. And here the word doesn't mean gracious as in grace, getting what you don't deserve. It means gracious in terms of excellence. F.B. Meyer says this, it's easy to lay aside malice, guile, and evil speaking when we are constantly feeding on the unadulterated milk of spiritual truth. Let me read that again because we're going to wrap. It's easy to lay aside malice, guile, and evil speaking, when we are constantly feeding on the unadulterated or untainted or the pure milk of spiritual truth, God's Word. If you have tasted of the grace of Jesus, if you have tasted of the excellency of Jesus, if you have tasted of the wonder of Jesus, here's what he says. You will not want to sip the wine of Sodom. Wow. Once you have tasted deeply of Jesus, the things of the world, I don't want them. I want to lay aside all malice, all deceit, hypocrisy, envy, and evil speaking. I've tasted the excellency of Jesus. Because he's given us a new life, because he's placed a new love within us, for us, and us for those that are around us, because we have God's unchanging and enduring word, therefore we are to lay aside, we are to put off, we are to separate ourselves from all in our actions, in our speaking, and in our thinking. We are to lay aside all malice, all deceit, all hypocrisy, envy, and all evil speaking. And as newborn babes, we should desire, we should yearn, we should be hungry for the pure milk of the Word that engages us, changes us, and transforms us, that we would grow thereby. Because you know what? We have tasted and fully appropriated that the Lord is gracious and most excellent. The psalmist says this, Psalm 34:8, "O taste and see that the Lord is good. Blessed is the man who," and this is so cool, "blessed is the man who trusts in him." See, the reality is, final idea, is if I'm trusting in Jesus, there's no need for me to be malicious. There's no desire for me to be deceitful. There's no hope of me being a hypocrite. Envy? Why would I even entertain the idea? And evil speaking? Who could possibly imagine? I'm in love with Jesus. I'm trusting Jesus. And I've tasted him, and I've seen that he is good, and nothing in the world holds a candle or compares to how wonderful and how glorious the Lord Jesus is. Now, on that foundational stone, next week, Peter will continue to build. And we'll look at that, and we'll enjoy that then. And you will rejoice with me over this coming week that I have next Sunday's sermon done. Right here. Praise the Lord. Father, thank you for ministering to our hearts this morning. Father, thank you for ministering to our hearts, not just with entertaining thoughts or ideas, but Father, ministering to us in a way that, Lord, you've caused us to engage. I've seen it in our faces. I've seen it in our eyes. Lord, we're in that place. We're walking through that zone of, Lord, we are laying aside. For most of us here, we're laying aside, and we're hungering, and we're desiring, and we're enjoying that pure, unadulterated milk of your word. But yet, Lord, there are those in this place, I have to imagine, there are those joining us over the internet this morning where, well, that really isn't the issue of their life. They are sipping from the wine of Sodom. They are like Lot, pitching their tent toward the things of this world. And Father, this morning they've been called to the place of making a choice, making a decision, going a new direction. Father, thank you that as you knock upon their heart, as they call out to you, Lord, you will meet them in that place of change and transformation. That, Father, as they would exercise their will to put off those things of the flesh, to set aside those things of the flesh, as they look to you, Lord, you will flood into their life love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, gentleness, self-control. And Father, you will change and transform them by the renewing of their mind. Father, thank you for the ways in which you've spoken to us this morning through these few verses. By the way, you have manifested your great love toward us. You haven't left us hopeless. Dessert's coming. You haven't left us helpless. You've given us your Holy Spirit. Father, all you've asked us to do is follow you. Feed on your word. Put you first. Step outside the bounds of our fleshly safety, our fleshly determination of what we think is good for us or good for our family, and throw ourselves fully upon you into the transforming work of your word. Lord, you really have made it so exceedingly simple. And Father, we're sorry for the times that we've made it difficult, either through the most cumbersome ways of our words that are used, or maybe for each of us individually or uniquely at certain times, putting up our own fences and our own roadblocks to what you want to do by your Spirit. Thank you, Lord, for peacefully and joyfully and graciously reminding us this morning of how easy it is to follow you, how easy it is to walk with you, what a blessing it is to walk with you, to remind us again, we mention so often, Lord, your yoke is easy. Your burden is light. And if our perspective is anything else than that, there's something that we're doing that's not of you. Father, thank you that you're faithful to identify those things in our life, those things that are not of you. You're faithful to identify them. You're faithful to help us put them off. You're faithful to help us walk with you. Thank you, Lord, that the truth and the reality is that in the last moment of this age, when we stand before you, we will look on and we will see that everything that's been accomplished in our life that was of any worth was you, beginning to end. In those places where you showed your brightest, you showed your grandest, you showed yourself with the most excellency, they were those places where we stepped away from the world and we looked to you and we allowed you to have your way with us. Where we took to heart those words, do not be conformed to this world, but be ye being transformed by the renewing of your mind through the milk of the uncorrupted, pure, unadulterated word, the Rhema, the spoken word of your Holy Scriptures. We love you, Lord Jesus. We thank you for ministering to us this morning. In your precious name we pray. Amen. Amen. Let's stand and let's worship.